Before I start speaking about the next one, piece number 13, a request, first of all, if it's possible to cut the coughing to a minimum. You are what, 16, 17 people, but you cough like an audience of 80. And if you have to cough, absolutely, try not to do it when I play very slowly and very quietly, because then it stands out. Look for the places where I really play loud and fast, and then nobody is going to notice a little cough, you know? That's my request. And now I'm going to start to speak about the next one. So we have two piano pieces that are called Sonata Quasi Una Fantasia. The second one is more well known as the Moonlight Sonata, and it will be after the intermission. Before that, we have a lovely little specimen, which is just amazing. It is written like a fantasy. What do I mean? You know that sonatas always have movement. The first movement, the second movement, the third movement. This one, if you don't know it very well, you cannot notice the movement, because it never stops. All of it, there are four movements, but they all come out of one another. And it's really confusing, it's really tricky. First of all, okay, we said that we're going to start with a slow movement, but suddenly in the middle of the first movement, in the slow movement, Beethoven is planting like a crazy run, virtuoso, forte, totally confusing, and after that he goes back to the first movement. So you ask yourself, is this the first movement, or did it change already? And then the movements connect, and also the same thing happened later. We have another slow movement in the third one, and then it goes to the finale, which is fast, but suddenly the third movement is coming back. By the way, this moment, the two moments like that in this piece, three moments actually, that it goes from fast to slow, they are just amazing, they are just incredible. You know, anybody, this is kind of my image, I always thought about it in that way. People from Israel, of course, know this story very well. Anybody knows here, anybody knows, how do you say in English, Haggadah shel Pesach?
Haggadah.
Yes, Haggadah, but nobody knows what it means, right? Anybody knows what is Pesach here in this place? You know, we just finished to celebrate Pesach in Israel. But everybody knows what is, Easter or Park or Passover or Pascha. Passover, no, Passover means Pesach actually. But you have this kind of thing. So, of course, the original event, we call it in Hebrew Pesach. Pesach, it comes from a certain root in Hebrew that means to skip over. And the original story, of course, was that the people of Israel were slaves in Egypt many thousands of years ago. And someday, God was trying to convince the king of Egypt to release the Jewish people. And one of the convincers that he did was kind of barbaric, but we must mention it because, you know, it's still in national memory. The angel of God was killing every firstborn in the families of the Egyptians, but there was a special sign, and he was skipping the houses of the people of Israel. He was skipping their houses, and from this thing, skipping, this is the origin of Pesach, and then it becomes Pak, yes. Easter is another kind of a word, of course, but this is really the origin of the thing. And we have this story later that the people of Israel, they ran out of Egypt in the middle of the night, and they didn't have time to bake their bread, you know, and they run like out of Egypt. And then, you know, all of the soldiers of the king of Egypt, they wake up in the middle of the night. What happens to the slaves? They're all gone. Let's run after them, let's catch them. And they go like with the heavy armor, you know, the metal armors and the shields and the swords, all very heavy. They were in very good physical shape probably. They run after them, and then God opens the sea, you know, and the people of Israel pass. There is a moment in this piece that it really sounds like that. The two hands are doing a virtuoso passage, each one goes a different direction, and then it stops, and then the slow movement is coming back. For me, this is really, it reminds me of this biblical story. I'm not going to demonstrate it, but you are going to recognize it when it arrives. It's near the end of the piece. It's really, there are three moments like this that it goes from fast back to slow. All of these moments are just, you get goosebumps. I promise, it's incredible effect. One more thing that happens in this piece before I present it. First of all, there is a lot of humor in this writing, because when I heard this music for the first time, I didn't believe, because you know, we grow up and we get educated. Okay, sneezing is okay, it's not the same, you cannot control it. I cannot control it. This is more acceptable. Not so pleasant, but what can you say? These are the forces of nature, we cannot argue with nature very much. A lot of vitamin C, I hear that it helps. In any case, we go back to, so, this music, you know, we always hear about the sonatas of Beethoven. These are very serious pieces, and you know, very classical, and we should treat them with a lot of respect. By the way, did you ever know that at one time a spaceship was sent in order to, you know, to present the human race to aliens, You know, with the drawings by Leonardo, this one that goes like that with the hands, and then they see all of the things that he has out, you know, and the other stories and things. And did you know that they put a recording of the 32 Beethoven sonatas on that spaceship to show the aliens, the intelligent aliens, what noise humans are capable of producing or something like this. In any case, it sounds very serious. And then the first time I listened to this piece at the beginning, I couldn't quite believe it because, I don't know, does it sound serious? Does it sound serious? Something that starts like that. It sounds a little bit like a nursery rhyme, no? And then later it goes. Keeps playing on it. Before it was like, and then the second time he repeats it, it becomes. It kind of plays with it the way that you do with the little child. And later after that, it becomes from this. It becomes this. There's a lot of humor. I don't know why he chose to start with such a nursery rhyme theme. But after that, something curious about this piece, and maybe it will give you some kind of a hint when a movement is starting, is that all of the other movements, they all start very quietly, and they all start very low on the piano. You have to look for them. Written really in a very